Hi, and welcome to my talk, User Interface Design. This is part of Compute 301, taught at the University of Alberta in the Department of Computing Science. I am Abram Hindle, and I'll be guiding you today. So, user interfaces are basically the method that we interact with machines. Unfortunately, we have to design user interfaces, and design is difficult. So Mitch Kapoor of Lotus says, the daily experience of using computers far too often is still fraught with difficulty, pain, and barriers for most people. This is true, even in the age of the Apple iPad and other such innovations in UIs, they're still hard to use. Try to get a iPad working with a complicated wireless network that has complicated authentication, and it's still not that fun. On the issue of poor usability, Samsung found that IT departments oftentimes neglect usability in the favor of cost. Oftentimes the usable stuff maybe costs more because it maybe took more money to make. And this sort of explains why you get stuck with a lot of really poor HR UIs, or if you've ever dealt with hospitals or health systems, a lot of the UIs there are very bad. An example of a poor UI is one that was designed by ATI engineers, and obviously they knew the components they were talking about, but this UI was really strange because if you clicked on various parts of the component, you'd get the frequency that it was at, you'd get various details about the chip or about the video card just by clicking on the components on the video card. But even worse, these weren't actual components on the video card. So you interacted by clicking on these things and you got different displays. That's not necessarily very intuitive for most people. So why is usability important? Well, usability is important because it affects the end customer. And in some studies, they found that the complexity of a product caused 50% of product returns. This is pretty common when a product doesn't work the way they expected, or they can't get it to work the way they expected, or maybe they can't access a certain feature. That complexity can oftentimes cause a product return. Some of this complexity comes from the fact that many times we try to jam too many features into something, and sometimes these features interact in poor ways. For instance, imagine that you're playing a video game, and you hit your power button, or your sleep, or your wake up. It's not a really great place for it. And do you need your turbo button there? Do you need the Windows keys there? Consider that maybe you don't need these features. Maybe all you want is the arrow keys and maybe control and an alt over here. So, it's important to remember that we as engineers, scientists, and programmers are not necessarily normal people. We have different kinds of training. So, one interesting user interface would be Google. Google has started off with a relatively simple user interface. You couldn't do much with it, but you could do things like select how many results you wanted, and they asked for your email, and they provided two options. How important was 10 results? Probably not a lot. What you wanted to do is you wanted to type in here, click Google search, or I'm feeling lucky, and get what you wanted. So Google has grown since then and has evolved, and they've fired designers and hired designers. But generally, if you go to this website about their user experience, they'll tell you it's about Google, it's about users, people, design, information, and all these other kinds of terms that they really care about. So they really want to focus on users and people. And that's the first step for design. So the new kind of Google has a bunch of extra stuff, but it's smaller. It's not by default. The web stuff at the top that you normally ignore unless you know you need it, it's all up there. You sort of know where to find it. You've got some simple links here, and you've got a much simplified version of that initial search right there. I'd argue that this is junk, and they probably should have gotten rid of that. So, when we're talking about software usability, there's some approaches we can deal with in order to improve or maintain usability of our product. One is to focus on the tasks that users have. The second would be to conduct studies of the users, that is, actually go and talk to them or actually go and see them use it. third would be to give your users the UI during design. So you can study what they need to do, what their tasks are. You could watch them do their tasks. And then when you design a solution, you should get feedback by providing your UI to the users to see if they can actually use it. Another good idea is to go search for good and bad examples of UI. Oftentimes you can do good UI design by pretty well cloning something else you saw that worked. Another good way is to use interface design guidelines. So these are common in Android, and these are common on iOS and on Apple. Another way is to employ graphic design. Graphic design is not just aesthetics. It's also some aspects of psychology which enable us to understand things visually. Furthermore, we can apply principles from psychology and sociology to improve usability. So one thing we want to do is we want to avoid surprises. If you surprise the user, they don't really know where they are. So if you think about Unix, one of the things that Unix does is it tends to drop vowels. So you can think about Unix commands like rm is supposed to be remove, ls is list, things like that. They tend to drop a lot of the vowels. So do we really need them? So try to read this. Hope you can read this sentence without the vowels. You can. It's sort of hard. It relies on basically information theory and you filling in the blanks. But you can do it. So in some cases you could get by. But if you wanted HP to be short for hope, people might not get it. Can you read this question? So this is relevant to Unix commands. A lot of them are dropping the vowels, but it's still not that surprising. Furthermore, our brains deal well with errors. So there was a study, although it's been sort of disproven, according to research at an English university, it doesn't matter in what order the letters and the words are. The only important thing is that the first and last letter is at the right place. Now, this isn't quite correct. When you have small words, like most of the words in the English language, like about 50% of them are less than 6 characters, which means that the permutations inside on the other 4 characters are very limited. So it's usually pretty obvious what's going on because there's not a lot of possibilities. Nonetheless, it is possible. So you can go read this result. And they found that, not necessarily this stuff, but that if you make the fonts harder to read, you cause the users to spend more effort and you can improve long-term learning. So sometimes being surprising can cause some kinds of good aspects, but in general, be careful about surprising the user in design. A lot of the things you want to do in design are copying patterns which already exist, what users are used to, so they can grapple onto what you're doing. So usability is relevant to the entire field of human-computer interaction. So humans have interacted with computers over the years using things like wires and then punch cards. Punch cards allowed us to interact with the computer where it had a punch card reader, which is relatively physical. And then we got into programming, we got into terminals, and we can type into the computer and have it record to files. And then eventually we got batch processing where we had a command line, an interactive command line. Whereas before, we would just send in like a punch card that had a command on it. Now we could actually type in the command at the command line. Eventually, this moved up to choices and prompts, like press A for choice, or do you want to do this, yes, no. And eventually, this moved into forms. And this was popular with TTYs for a long time. So you even see this nowadays, where people have these dumb terminals as point-of-sale devices, and they interact with a back-end. And eventually that moved from sort of textual forms into graphical user interfaces that we use today, and eventually point-and-click, like the mouse here, and then touch-based and gesture-based, which is where the phones are at right now. So that was basically the history of human-computer interaction. We've gone from wiring it up to waving in front of a Kinect, and it recognizing that we're human. So, we're talking about usability, right? we're talking about software. One of the ways that people interact with software is via graphical user interface. So it's important that we adhere to some principles of designing graphical user interfaces such that we can aid the user in understanding it. So the first one is the user in control. So the user should be in control of the UI. They are controlling it. They should know what's going on. If the UI changes modes, if the UI changes modes on the user, it can be very confusing. But one should also consider that the user has tasks to be done. So while we can constrain the user an incredible amount, they still have work to do. So what do we want to do regarding that work? So what you provide in terms of modes can provide a bit of a barrier in terms of what the user wants to achieve. If the user doesn't understand the modes that you are providing, like say you're in edit mode or delete mode or insert mode, rather than just a general edit mode, they might not understand how to use the system. The principle is the user should be in control and they are guiding the software. So you should listen to them and you should allow them to do what they want to do. So you should model the task that they have and try to deal with that. The next principle is manipulate objects. So in a graphical user interface, it's oftentimes useful to have selection of objects, like nouns, and then actions done to them. So if you right-click on something, usually that provides actions. So if you click on it, that says you're selecting the subject, the noun. So the idea is you interact in this sort of subject-predicate kind of situation where you're executing actions on subjects, right? Furthermore, you should care about the visibility of objects of interest. So if it's important, it should probably be visible. What you should be trying to do is try and exploit them understanding the object by recognition, not by remembering what it meant. So if you had a big box in this corner and through prior use they figured out that's the save button, that would be recall. If you had like a floppy disk or a hard drive or writing down on a piece of paper or something like an icon like that, that would be exploiting recognition. Furthermore, the symbol or the visibility of the object suggests what kind of affordance, what kind of interaction it can deal with. So if you want people to drag and drop things onto something, you should probably make like a surface that looks like it will hold objects, like a kind of panel. Whereas if you don't want something to be selected or it's unselectable, maybe you'll gray it out to imply that there's no way they can click it, that it's not in active use. Other underlying principles include incremental action and rapid feedback. Basically, you want to, when they select an object, show them that they selected. Furthermore, when an object is moved on the screen, you should show that it's moved or that it's resized. So immediately things should be shown. This immediacy is very important, especially in a touch interface, because in a touch interface, if they don't have immediate feedback, they will press harder. They will think that they need to apply more force in order for the machine to listen. Because when you touch something and you're trying to click it, basically if it doesn't move, it usually means it's heavy. So if something's heavy, you push harder. So by providing immediate feedback, the user won't push so hard. So you won't get like an accidental long click at Android or something like that. Furthermore, users make mistakes. We have to accept this. So you should provide instant undo, canceling, and you should allow the user to explore the application without harming them. A lot of people were raised using machinery where you could not explore the machinery without damaging it. We are using software. Software doesn't have to be built in a way in which the user experience is really nasty and that it stops them from exploring because it has has really negative connotations or it has destructive connotations. So the idea is that if you allow the user to reverse their actions, they will be able to explore and understand your software easier. If they can't reverse their actions, like say writing a DVD, where you can't unwrite the DVD unless it's rewritable, that's pretty dangerous and it limits exploration. They might be really scared of wasting a dollar on a DVD just to try a new feature. So, you should also adhere to every choosable action is legal. This means gray out invalid choices. If they have, say, selected that their dietary type is vegetarian, maybe you shouldn't bother providing them with meat alternatives or meat options. Alternatively, if they choose one path in the user interface, you should probably gray out invalid choices because they chose certain parameters. So one thing you can do with user interfaces is by exploiting metaphors. This is much like the prior suggestion that we manipulate objects using a sort of noun verb interaction. So using this this is basically a metaphor of language and commands. But the metaphor we're talking about here is where we have familiar settings, that is places, scenes, things that they know, like desktops, a tabletop, a menu at a restaurant, rooms, shopping carts. Those kinds of settings allow them to grapple on to new concepts. So if you can have the concepts be relevant and similar, perhaps the users can understand better. Fortunately, metaphors can only go so far. Think about the Mac, a trash can on the desktop. Do you have a trash can on your desk, or is it usually under the desk? Furthermore, does dragging a disk to a trash can, does that really mean eject to you, or is that a separate kind of interaction? Furthermore, with these metaphors, this disk to trash issue, you don't want to carry the metaphor to non-intuitive situations. So if drag and drop isn't really natural to the situation, don't support it. Furthermore, there can be cultural differences in UIs. Oftentimes, menus imply the availability of choice. When there aren't choices, be aware of your audience. So here's an example of a metaphor. This was a kind of office desktop management system, and it was by Sony. So you had games, you had files, you had applications like an address book, phone numbers, diary, notes, files, time. And then there's other things you could do, like you could go contact America Online, you could use chat. But notice how these are pretty cultural as well. Like many people wouldn't know what this kind of sign suggests, right? So they tried to take the metaphor pretty far. They tried to take the real world metaphor. But it gets a little weird, like, oh, there's a calculator in that drawer. Well, why not just have a calculator? So consider the effect of taking a metaphor too far. This is QuickTime. QuickTime tried to take the metaphor of a video player in order to allow people to play videos in QuickTime. So DVD players and VHS players used to look a lot like this. And they even go as far as taking the brushed metal look, which was sort of popular near the end of VHS. So a gray brushed metal look. So they tried to look like the video player itself. And this is an example of using a metaphor. And this one's relatively effective because most people understand stop and pause and play and pause. Unfortunately, you can take it too far. This is a PostScript driver for a printer, and it's printing to the printer, and it gives you stop, pause, and, I don't know, rewind for a printer. It gives you the same kind of options here, but it's sort of inappropriate because really you want it to say stop printing altogether, like cancel, or to pause the printing because you have to do something. This kind of interface here, while it's trying to be intuitive, It's sort of confusing given the fact that this isn't as relevant to, say, video playing as this is. So, let's look at this. Let's look at this UI right now. So it says book a flight. It allows you to book flights. There's departure dates. There's arrival dates. There are options for one-way round trip to and from. You type in airport code. What kind of price you want to pay and how many passengers. Here we've got an execute and the cancel. So, right now, you have an exercise. So, if you can pause the video once I'm done speaking, do so. I want you to look at this UI, and I want you to find user interface problems with the UI. Okay? So, I'm going to count down to 10, from 10, and you should pause the video during that time, and then you should think about what are user interface problems in this video. And then after I count down, I'll cover the user interface problems I see in this video, in this image right here. Okay? So, pause the video. 10, 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. And we're back. All right. So I hope that you took some time to think about what's wrong with this user interface. Well, one thing you should notice is that one-way and round-trip are basically mutually exclusive. If you did a round-trip, you're not doing a one-way. If you do a one-way, you're not doing a round-trip. This means that checkboxes are inappropriate. What should you use? You should probably use a radio button or a drop-down. Radio buttons or drop-downs limit and constrain the user input. For the departure date, we've got January, and then we've got dates here. If this doesn't update, right, if that doesn't update, then you can select invalid dates, like February 31st. So consider that maybe a better UI component would be maybe a calendar that opens up. So when you select date, it switches. Another negative aspect here is that these inputs take any kind of input. If you go to a modern website, what you'll find is that you can type the IATA codes, right? You can type them into a modern website, but what they will do is they will usually code complete the destination. Also, they help you query. So let's see. Let's go to Expedia, and we can see in Expedia right here that I could type in the date, but I can also click on the date. And I can type in the airport code, and it suggests an airport. But if I don't know the airport code of where I'm going, like Los Angeles, I can start typing it in. But do you see how fast it is to click the dates and to select the dates? Furthermore, I know what time, I know what day it's on. Okay, so that's an improvement. Another improvement is I can select how many adults, right? I can't select an invalid value, except for maybe zero. So if I go 000, see, it gives me a warning. All right. Okay, so the number of passengers was another problem because it allowed them to type in anything they wanted to. So there's multiple problems here. Those are just some of them. So the important aspect of user interface design is usually just consistency, consistency, consistency. And this means predictability. What comes next should be clear about what came before. It should be generalizable. Specific cases extend to new situations. If you wrote a DVD one way, maybe other ways to write the DVD, like to add videos to it, should be done that way as well. Furthermore, it should be predictable on how to build the kind of DVD you're looking at if you're making DVD building software. Furthermore, things should be stable. Basically, if you place buttons in places they normally go, people will rely on recall to click and find those buttons. Many of you do this when you think about the yes, no, cancel buttons. You usually know where yes is, and maybe you're clicking it furiously. Okay? So, consistency, consistency, consistency. We want predictability. We want to know, we need to be able to figure out where we're going from what came before. Generalizable. The specific cases we learned should apply to new situations. So, if we have a drag and drop UI, drag and drop should make sense. Stability, we want to make sure that the parts of the user interface don't fly all over the place and they're relatively consistent. Furthermore, there is a lexical consistency. These are general kinds of rules of thumb that people usually follow. So, left is less, right is more. So if I show you something like VLC, we can see here there's a volume button, right? Right is more, 200%, left is less. Right is more, left is less. Furthermore, you should use consistent abbreviations. You shouldn't mix Jan in January. You shouldn't mix Feb in January. You should use, say, all equal length. So if you use consistent abbreviation rules, people understand. Furthermore, you should use symbols consistently. So if dot 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 brings up a dialog from a button, then that's consistent. Furthermore, if you use like a stop button or different kinds of symbols, they should be the same all throughout. So in many cases, dot 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 on the web indicates that they're not showing you all the information. And if you click it, usually you get more information, it will expand. So if dot 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 does something else, it might surprise people and irritate them. So if we look here, what's consistent about this? So stop for a minute, and I want you to think about this UI and what is consistent about it. So I'll count down from 5, you stop the video, you think about it, and then you click play again. So 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. Now we're back. So what is consistent about this UI? Well, first of all, we've got the file menu. And in the file menu, we put new, and we put open, right? And we put save, and we put print. These things on a Macintosh are consistent. They're usually file usually has new, file usually has open, file usually has save. These are things relevant to files. Furthermore, it has printer interaction. Usually file has printer stuff. If you went to edit, what would you find? You'd probably find cut, copy, paste, and maybe undo, right? If you went to help, you'd probably find help. If you went to window, you'd probably find that it would open up other kinds of windows. This kind of consistency lets people navigate your user interface without explicit training. Furthermore, another kind of consistency here is these shortcut keys. So these shortcut keys let you call these functions with keyboard shortcuts, but they're generally consistent across applications. Like Alt-N and Alt-O do pretty well the same thing. Or Alt-N makes new ones, Alt-O opens, Alt-S saves. You want this to be consistent because if in other apps they use this to save constantly, they're going to use it to constantly save in your app. So, the order of the menu items is also consistent, but also the subject of the menu items in the menu is consistent. Furthermore, the order of the menu items like file and edit are consistent. So here's examples of more consistency on the Mac. Now, the Mac is actually a very consistent user interface. There's plenty of counterexamples, but for the most part, their UIs and dialogues do a pretty good job. So over here, we've got devices and places, and then directories and then files. We got back and forth, that's usually consistently there. This open dialog is the same open dialog you get for just about every single application. Your font dialog always looks this way, where you got collections, families, typefaces, sizes, shows you what it looks like, lets you control a little bit. Then there's the color palette. You can always use this color palette if you want. Furthermore, the printer dialog is usually standard and it provides feedback. You can also see they provide useful icons that show you what the orientation is. They don't bother trying to tell you if it's landscape or not, or profile or not. They give you an example of a person, and you can immediately tell if it's landscape or not. So this is a good example of platform consistency. All right, so we finished off the user interface stuff, and I want you to really, really notice that they've got consistency going on, lots and lots of consistency. We've got user interface problems, like not limiting kinds of inputs, having freeform inputs where wrong values can be input, and having sort of awkward inputs that still can have incorrect input. We've got examples of metaphors, like a DVD player metaphor, but they can be used inappropriately, so metaphor use is not always positive. Furthermore, we're relevant to computer interaction, usability, user interfaces are relevant to human-computer interaction. So in your projects, what you should consider is you want to enable the user to be in control, they should be able to manipulate objects, and it should make sense. You should exploit the recognition, not the recall. The user should understand what your buttons mean, what your symbols mean, and they should understand it. Like plus, oftentimes on Android, means add. So if you want to add something, maybe a plus is a good idea. Furthermore, you probably want to take a metaphor, but you don't want to go too far with it. Other things you should watch out for is you want predictability. It should be obvious what comes next. If they do one task one way, the other tasks should probably be done that way if they're generalizable, if they're similar. So for our current class, we're making a choose your own adventure. So the writing of a story and the editing of a story should probably be generalizable. It should probably be pretty similar. Furthermore, the adding of story arcs should be generalizable as well as it is to, say, make a new story. Those things can be generalized. Furthermore, there's stability issues. You want your UI to be consistent. You don't want buttons flying all over the place, so you want the layout to be static. All right. Thank you for your time. This was part one of user interfaces. The next video coming up will probably be graphic design. All right.